morning.
Morning.
Good morning.
It's a great day to be in the house of God, isn't it?
Amen.
No matter what the weather's like outside, no matter what the trials are we might be going through, we're in the house of God, we're in one family. On that Mark 7, when I started reading and asking the Lord what I needed to preach about, I was a bit surprised to see Jesus call a woman a dog. Am I on mute? How's that? Thank you. Now, to set the surprise part, I'm going to share with you seven surprises. Seven's perfect. Did you know that the state capital of Texas is taller than the state capital of the United States? I think I'm really impressed. Maybe this one will catch your attention. The electric chair was invented by a dentist. Well, that makes sense, doesn't it? Alfred Southwick got the idea when he heard about a drunk, intoxicated man who bumped up against an electric generator and was executed. The microwave was invented by a researcher who walked past a radar tube and the chocolate in his pocket melted. Sherlock Holmes never actually said elementary, my dear Watson. How many chocolate lovers do we have here? Every second, America collectively eats 100 pounds of chocolate. Every second. A snail can sleep for 3 years. Anybody want to guess what the most shoplift book is? The Bible. Most of that shoplifting is actually out of hotels, the Gideon Bibles. But I was surprised and I was puzzled. And sometimes Scripture records events and puzzles. And today's passage might puzzle you, might even leave you with questions. And that's all right, because God can handle any question that we might want to ask. So this is the story of the Syrophoenician woman. It's a mirror of a similar story of the centurion. Both were long-distant miracles, and both were Gentiles. Mark 7:26. This woman was a Greek, a Syrophoenician woman. Mark uses repetition here. Jesus is trying to help the disciples to understand that the kingdom of God is not limited to the Jews.
Amen.
And I believe that Mark is including this story to help us understand that the kingdom of heaven in 2018 is not limited to the Seventh-day Adventist church. But God loves everyone. And he's longing for everyone to be in heaven. Unfortunately, we realize that won't happen because people will choose not to love Jesus. And this woman comes, she's coming to Jesus for her daughter. The scripture says that her daughter had an unclean spirit. It literally means that her daughter had a foul-mouthed spirit, a morally unclean spirit. And this woman was at wit's end. I can imagine that she had tried the local psychologist and the psychiatrist. She probably had tried doctors, maybe even witch doctors. Nothing worked. Her daughter was out of control, and she was at her wit's end. And she heard about this prophet Jesus. And so she is there in Mark 7 for the benefit of her daughter. Now, remember Jesus calls her a dog. Now, would you ever call a woman a dog? I hope you wouldn't. I hope we wouldn't put people in those kind of boxes, but sometimes we do. I was attending a workshop in which the presenter said that People who do not frequent church events or religious events don't like to be called the lost. You ever thought of refer to someone as lost? That person's lost, they don't know Jesus. They would prefer to be called spiritual but not religious. And we're good at putting people in boxes. We refer to people as lost or as pagan. And when I was pastoring in Rapid City, South Dakota, I couldn't call anybody a pagan. Because one of my elders, his last name was Pagan. It wouldn't be appropriate for me to say bad things about people using his name. Sometimes we put people in boxes by calling them non-believers. Sometimes we put them in a box by calling them non-Seventh-day Adventists. Except that makes them less a Christian. In this story, this woman approaches Jesus. Now, in the culture of Jesus' times, rabbis or teachers did not speak to women in public. Now, if you hold your finger at Mark 7 and flip over to Matthew 15, these are the two stories told, or the story told by the two gospel writers. Matthew 15, verse 23, this woman prostrates herself in front of Jesus. It's a sign of reverence, a sign of worship. He did not answer her a word. And then his disciples came and begged him, send her away because she keeps on crying out after us. One of the things about Christianity is that we are to be compassionate and caring people. The disciples were not very compassionate in this story, and they're not very caring. And Jesus is trying to help them understand, because he knows he's going to die on the cross. He knows he's going to ascend to heaven. He knows these men are going to be left to lead the church. And they're complaining about this woman who is desperate for her daughter to be saved. And Jesus begins to engage her in a conversation. It sounds at first like he's refusing her. He's actually inviting her close to his heart. He's wanting so badly to answer her request, but he desperately needs to help his disciples to understand the mission that he is calling them to. And he needs us to understand the mission he's calling you and I to see every individual we encounter as a potential child of God.
Amen.
Now, in Jesus' time, it was common for Jews to refer to Gentiles as dogs. But it wasn't received very pleasantly. And you can imagine, how would you feel if someone called you that? And Jesus reminds the disciples that God sent him to the lost of Israel. And he wanted the disciples to understand the lost sheep of Israel included this Canaanite woman. She was the lost sheep. Israel should have been reaching out to people like her.
Yeah.
Instead, they were turning their backs on her and calling her a dog. He needed to understand that mission. That everybody is of value. That everybody is special in the eyes of God. Even though this woman is referred, even though Jesus says this woman, the food must go first to the house of Israel. And he refers crumbs to the dogs. And she responds with great wit. And it's pretty amazing how quickly she picked up what appeared to be an insult. She realized was not an insult, but an encouragement of hope. Jesus did not admire this woman's wit. He admired her faith.
Amen.
I want to look at four types of faith. There's great faith that approaches Jesus boldly. And this woman does that very thing. She approaches him boldly. She throws herself at his feet and she cries out for me. Now some people saw Jesus not as their Messiah, but as the miracle worker, the man who would feed them. They wouldn't have to work anymore, they wouldn't have to fish anymore, they wouldn't have to farm anymore, they'd just hang around Jesus and he would feed them and heal them and take care of their problems. Jesus took the disciples to this quiet place. It's interesting that Mark says he went to a quiet place, and then he contrasts it with this obnoxious woman who won't stop calling out. Now, in her culture, a Greek woman would never speak to a Jew. It would just be inappropriate. In her culture, a woman would never speak to a man in public unless it was family. So in a sense, she's crashing a party. She's kind of like the unknown guest who shows up at a party and goes to the person at the head of the party and says, can you provide me with some battery cables to start my car? It was weird, strange. In Matthew's account, remember Matthew, he is tailoring his gospel to help the Jews realize that Jesus is the King of Kings. In Matthew's account, the woman says, Lord, Son of David, have mercy on me. My daughter is suffering terribly. Now, Mark doesn't include this because Mark wants us to see the Messiah as a servant. And so we understand that our mission is as a servant. But it's clear in Matthew's statement, this woman recognizes Jesus not only as a prophet, not only as a man who works miracles, but she recognizes him as the Messiah. She recognizes him in a way that the disciples have not yet recognized him. Her daughter is tormented by demons. She's not asking something for herself. She is there interceding on the behalf of her daughter. There is great power in intercession. In Hebrews 4:16, Paul wrote, let us then approach the throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. We need to be prayer warriors, interceding on the behalf of this community, on the behalf of the family of this congregation. We need to be prayer warriors for each other. And we must not give up in prayer. We had a gentleman come to an evangelistic meeting in Rapid City. Someone had been sending him signs of the times for years. It had been 20 years. And every time it came in his mailbox, he threw it away. Someone was praying for that man every day. And he told us as he gave his testimony that one day he saw an article on the front of the magazine that caught his attention. And the Lord impressed him on going to the evangelistic meeting, and he regained his life for Jesus Christ. He'd been raised in Adventist, lost his way. Someone had been praying for that man for 20 years. We need to be perseverance as intercessors for our church, for our families, for our community. Like the statement someone made that unanswered prayer is that the situation is desperate, but the saints are not. Are you desperate enough to trust Jesus unconditionally? The second thing of faith is that great faith doesn't quit when insulted.
Amen.
Now, she was insulted. Have you ever been insulted? You ever had someone treat you in a way that you really didn't appreciate? In Matthew 15:24, it says, I was sent only to the lost sheep of Israel. And it wouldn't be proper to take the children's bread and toss it to who? The dogs. And she recognized that Jesus was comparing her, a Gentile, to dogs. In the Greek, we try to soften this up a little bit. Surely Jesus wouldn't use such words. It literally means a little puppy or a small house dog. But a dog is a dog, isn't it?
Yes.
And according to one rabbi, the prayer of the Pharisee is, Lord, I thank you that I was not born a Gentile, a dog, or a woman. Isaiah compared false prophets to dogs. Paul wrote to the believers, watch out for the dogs. He was referring to false teachers, not to cocker spaniels. How do you respond when you're insulted? Proverbs 12:16 says, a fool is quick-tempered, but a wise person stays calm when insulted. You like that?
Amen.
Stay calm. No one's been in your sandals to understand the trials you're going through. But when we're insulted, someone might say, you call me a dog, you're a dog. You ever been tempted to do that? Respond angry with anger? Or somebody just walk away and say, certainly, he's not a Christian. He wouldn't talk that way if he was. He's just a male chauvinist, rude Jew. Are you persistent in your prayers? Or are you tempted to give up because you don't get the answers you're wanting? Remember Matthew 7:7, Jesus said, ask and you shall receive, seek and you shall find, knock and the door shall be opened. Literally is saying, keep asking, keep seeking, keep knocking, don't stop.
Amen.
You wouldn't go to someone's house and knock one time, would you? And walk away and nobody's home? Sometimes you have knocked many times. Some people are hard of hearing. Jesus is saying to us in Matthew 7, don't quit on people. Keep praying them, keep lifting them up to the heavens. Be persistent. Genesis 2 is a great example of Jacob, who was facing a dangerous encounter with his brother Esau and his 400 soldiers. Because Jacob had stolen his birthright. Jacob had stolen his blessing. That night, Jacob cried out to God, Lord, save me from the hand of my brother. And that all that night, Jacob spent in prayer. In the morning, he clung to the angel. He had Nelson's grip on him. And Jacob said, I will not let go until you bless me. And the angel said, your name is no longer Jacob. Your name is now Israel. And from Jacob, we learn the importance of persistence. Don't let go of God until he blesses you. Don't let go in your prayers for people because they haven't been answered. Just keep praying.
Amen.
The third is great faith is content with the crumbs of grace. Jesus said, it is not right to take the children's bread and throw it to the dogs. But she did not miss a beat. She said, yes, Lord, but even the puppies under the table get the children's crumbs. What an amazing woman. She's a Gentile. Mark is embarrassed that she is such a giant of faith. And the disciples are still in first grade. She was saying, Lord, I may be a puppy. But you're so powerful that I don't need the first sermon. Just like puppies, I'll be happy to feed on the crumbs of your grace, and that will be enough to save my daughter. She's just demonstrated great faith and great humility. Are you a humble person? Would you raise your hand if you're humble? Ah, you're wise. A young man was given a button that said, humble. And he wore it to church, and they took it away from him. They said, you're not humble. If you have to advertise it, you're not humble. Do your feelings get hurt quickly? And always wondering how to get even with someone. Do you react negatively if someone calls you a dog or something else? We need humility. How many of you own a dog? Good for you. How many of you own a cat? Well, actually, you're misled. Dogs have owners. Cats have servants. We need to learn to be content with God and His answers to our prayers. But He says yes or no or wait. We need to be content. We need to be willing to eat the crumbs. The Apostle Paul knew what it was to feed on crumbs. He was in prison and he was content. And he wrote these words in Philippians 4 from the prison when he wrote, I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do everything through Him who gives me strength. The secret of this woman's faith was that she wasn't ashamed to beg for the crumbs of grace. She didn't mind being called a dog. She was humble. 1707, Isaac Watts wrote that great hymn, Alas, Did My Savior Bleed. The first line says, Alas, did my Savior bleed, and did my sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred head for such a worm as I? Well, some churches decided that was a little harsh. So they changed it, the word worm, and said, would he devote the sacred head for sinners such as I? Well, some hymnals decided that they're calling people sinners was like calling them dogs. So they said, would he devote the sacred head for someone such as I? And someone has suggested the next reversion will be, I don't need that sacred head because I'm good. We are that lonely worm, aren't we? We need to accept the gift of humility. And that fourth great test is that faith is tested by God. It is not right to take the children's bread and throw it to dogs. And if you scan the picture, you might see Peter and John doing a high five, saying to Jesus, just smack that Gentile down. He said, I can imagine them saying, did you hear what he called her? He called her a dog. And I can imagine Jesus had a twinkle in his eye and a smile on his face. Yes, he was testing her. Yes, he longed to answer her request. Matthew says, Yes, Lord. She said, but even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from the master's table. Then Jesus answered, woman, you have great faith. And your request is granted. I long for Jesus to say, Dennis, you have great faith. Because without faith, it's impossible to please God. Without faith, we do not receive the rewards of God. And God tests our faith. He was testing this woman, testing her humility, her perseverance. And sometimes we don't realize we're being tested. We just think we're having problems. And God has allowed us to walk through fires. But the good news is He is walking with us through those fires. Apostle Peter wrote in 1:7, he said, these trials will show that your faith is genuine. It is being tested as fire tests and purifies gold, though your faith is far more precious than of gold. How we act reflects our reputation. How we react reveals our character. There's a true story of a young man named Bill, who was invited to interview as a missionary. The problem here is he had to go to Wisconsin in the dead of the winter. It'd be like going to Michigan in the dead of winter. And the missionary told him, be at my house at 4:30 in the morning. So he traveled all night to get to this man's house. At 4:30 in the morning, he knocked on the door, and nobody answered. He knocked and knocked. So finally, the missionary's wife in her robe opened the door and said, may I help you? And he explained why he was there, and she let him in. His appointment was at 4:30 in the morning. He sat and waited for the missionary, the retired missionary. It was 5:30, 6:30, 7:30. Finally, at 8:30, the missionary came down. And he says, Bill, I have one question for you. Can you spell the word Bible? Of course, Bill said, yes, B-I-B-L-E. He said, thank you. We'll be in contact with you and let you know if you've been accepted. But Bill figured that he must have failed the interview. Surely he had asked him more questions. He had studied this manual. He was ready. He was surprised a week later when the missionary board called him and said, please come. And the retired missionary said to the board, I have tested this young man, and he is worthy of the call to be a missionary. Ooh. And Bill said, that can't be right. You didn't interview me. I mean, I got to your house and you asked me one question. He said, first, young man, I tested your diligence. Anyone who would travel to Wisconsin in the middle of the winter is determined. He said, secondly, I tested your punctuality. You were there a few minutes before. He says, I was awake and saw you arrive at the door of my house. Thirdly, he says, I tested your patience. You sat there for 4 hours and did not complain. He said, patience is an important quality for a missionary. He said, finally, I tested your humility. I asked you a question that even a third grader could answer. And you were not insulted or offended. The problem with God testing our faith is oftentimes we don't realize it's a test. In 1976 and 1997, you used to hear that thing that would say, this is a test. They finally quit doing that. They have other kinds of tests now, but they finally quit doing that. It was annoying, wasn't it? Sometimes God is saying to us, this is a test. This is only a test. Martin Luther wrote when he was 62 years old. He was nearing the end of his life. And he says, we are all beggars at God's table. We are not worthy to gather up the crumbs under the table, but nonetheless God invites us to come and to eat the morsels of the bread of heaven and to drink of the cup of salvation. When we beg, God cannot but notice our love for him. And we need to be bold enough to say, Lord, may I have the scraps. We are bold enough to choose not to be insulted and not to be offended. This woman went away, and her daughter no longer had that foul spirit. She was healed. What a missionary she became for Jesus. We need to be missionaries, sharing with people how Jesus has changed our lives. Amen?
Amen.
So let's stand together and sing our closing song. 371. Let's commit our lives to Jesus Christ.